That was perfect timing. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the members, friends, relatives of friends, guests, and everybody online or in the future to the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Potsdam. I'm Mary Ryan. I'm the lay leader this morning. Chad Towarnicki is our speaker. Carly Schell, our pianist. Emily Quarles Maurer is doing the tech duties, and she's my director. And Finn Towarnicki will light the chalice this morning. The Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Pottstown, known more commonly as the UUFP, has been a liberal religious voice in Pottstown for 55 years, way back since 1967. We believe that every person matters, and diversity is a gift, and it's something to be celebrated. And we come here from all different places and backgrounds and for different reasons. But we're here because we've decided we want to be with this fellowship family this morning. Every service is different, and they vary from week to week. We have different voices, different varieties. Sometimes they're internal, like today. Sometimes we bring in ministers, and sometimes we bring in other experts on things. But we hope that we will always touch your spirit, your heart, and your mind. So whoever you are, wherever you come from, and wherever you are, and wherever, whomever you love, I'm so glad you're here with us today. And I don't think we have any first timers. No. And everybody's invited to join us for coffee hour after in the social hall in the back. Look like there's a nice big coffee cake. Coffee cake always entices people to come. So it's back there after the service. So now, is there any announcements? Okay, don't make me feel. All right. Cool. All right, our chalice lighting this morning is by Mark Chaucy. We light this chalice, spark of the original fire of creation, to remind us that we all on this planet, the furred, the feathered, the finned, the scaled, along with us featherless bipeds, we are all made of the same star stuff and all share a common destiny. We all share the same hopes of a life free from harm and suffering, and the same aspirations of happiness, love, and flourishing. Being able to express our own unique natures and capacities as best we may. We are just that many diverse perspectives from which the whole is seen and experienced. We are inextricably intertwined, interconnected, and interdependent, and it is good. Blessed be. So please stay seated and sing Spirit of Life, number 123. All right, now Chad is going to come up and he's going to read Do a Reading by Ralph Waldo Emerson. Chad's a as a is a teacher, so an English teacher. So he's going to he's going to be good. And you notice the difference in the height here, so I never know whether.
I learned a lot about what goes into putting these presentations together, so it made me have a new appreciation for everybody who's ever presented to see the mechanism behind everything, and I never even knew that you stood on a stool. So I just read what Emily is going to speak about next week, and this poem hopefully applies to what I'm talking about, but I think it also applies to what next week might be about. And Ralph Waldo Emerson has this quote that says, the only person you're destined to become is the person you decide to be. So I think that quote might speak to what Emily is talking about next week, but it also speaks to this poem. It's pretty short. And the gist of it is basically, it aligns with my talk because it's about the gifts that kind of we all bring to the table and it makes our community stronger. So Ralph Waldo Emerson, which I've heard a couple of talks about him, has really influenced the way I think about morality and stuff. So that's why I kind of wanted to start with him. So he uses a metaphor between a mountain speaking to a squirrel. The mountain and the squirrel had a quarrel, and the former called the latter a little bug. The squirrel replied, "You are doubtless very big, but all sorts of things and weather must be taken in together to make up a year on this sphere. And I think it no disgrace to occupy my place. If I'm not so large as you, you are not so small as I, and not half so spry. I'll not deny you make a very pretty squirrel track, but talents differ. All is well and wisely put. If I cannot carry a forest on my back, well, neither can you crack a nut."
Now, Justine will do the story for all ages, and she'll let me know whether they're going to stay or go to RV.
Tried to get a story about bees, but I couldn't find one. So I brought Be a Tree, and this is by Maria John Ferrari. Be a Tree. Be a tree, stand tall, stretch your branches to the sun. Let your roots curl, coil the soil to brown you. Your spine is a trunk giving you shape, holding your crown, challenging your food. Your skin is bark, dead on the outside, protecting what's within. Beneath your bark are layers such as sapwood, carrying nutrients to help you grow bigger and taller, and heartwood, strong as bones, to support you. And your heart center is your pit, keeper of nutrients when you were a sapling. So how does the author describe the tree's features and characteristics? What does it remind you of? And then, okay, so we're leading into humans. Yeah. I want to do something different. High above your crown may be round, weeping, pyramidal, raw. Let it spread, shine overhead, collecting sun, filtering dust, shading your roots on hot days. Wave your leaves in the wind, breathe in air, drink in sun, let them feel you and the world. See yourself, branches and leaves above, roots above, think in between, you are a tree. And now look around you. You are not alone. You are one of many trees. Our roots twine with fungi, joining all trees in the forest together. We talk, share food, store water, divide resources, alert each other to danger. Do you think humans do the same thing? A wood wide web of information. We purify the air, we anchor the soul, preventing erosion. Our dome of joint crowds swing the straightens, slowing high winds. Our bodies and branches and roots are homes to birds, mammals, and insects. We sustain ecosystems. Okay, so how do the animals and creatures benefit from the tree's acceptance? How do you think? How do they accept them? And any ideas? How are they accepted? By the animals and the other creatures accepted by the tree? Okay, I think that's good there. We can work together. Immigrant trees from the native habitats are vulnerable, but together a forest of trees is strong. Mother trees nurse young trees. Old trees shade new trees. Strong trees shelter weak trees. Healthy trees help sick trees. Family, a community, a country, a cosmos. There is enough for all. So we agree, four together, we are a forest. What are some things that you do to accept other people? Kind of like the tree accepts everybody and everything. Do you accept people for who they are?
Yeah.
That's a good example. Or... Okay. Well, this kind of goes with what Chad's gonna talk about. And I don't know, are we doing underneath this? Yeah, okay, we'll stay here then.
Okay, since I still have children in the room, I'd like to have here, and if you could each pass the basket for our offering to help keep all the lights on. And it's this is what's kept us going for these 55 years and helped us survive COVID. So thank you very much for your generosity. Oh yeah, I screwed up. The choir will now sing.
We'll let you know.
Doesn't match the program. So we're going to actually have two songs in a row. Should have had the choir stay up because this is a new one. Number 76, Flowers That Bloom About Our Feet. And then after that, Chad will come up and do his talk on the new residents of our fellowship, actually.
So just to build my paper for this situation, I'm going to start how I kind of start my classes, and that's with you guys spending 90 seconds talking to each other. And so you are either going to identify a gift that you bring to the table, something that you're proud, that you enjoy, that you're good at, that you bring to the table, or you look at the person sitting next to you, and then you tell them a gift that you love, that you recognize in them. So you can choose to do it however you want, but you're going to spend 90 seconds talking to each other. And if you're the ultimate introvert, please think about it, or if you're somebody at home from Zoom, you spend 90 seconds meditating on it, okay? Go ahead, discuss. Okay, 20 seconds. No, it's fine. Okay. So now we're going to begin. So good. Okay, you did much better first thing in the conversation than my general 14-year-old clientele. So I adapted an article that I wrote for the American Bee Journal to explain a little bit about bees, but also to reflect a little bit on my experience with UU over these last 6 months. So it revolves around what I think is the most bee principle, which is the third principle, acceptance of one another and encouragement of spiritual growth in our congregations. And I argue that that is like, that's just being a bee. So a few years ago, an article ran in the Philly Inquirer entitled "Philly Millennials Are Buzzing About Beekeeping." And they were citing a youth movement interested in having a hands-on positive impact in an environment. And it wasn't until after reading that article that I Googled who the millennials are. Now that I am a millennial, I have the unflattering designation of being a geriatric millennial. So the article begged the question, why the resurgence in beekeeping at a time when this terrible parasite known as Varroa destructor, myriad of diseases, pesticide contamination, and township regulations can make it a difficult task to see through to your first jar of honey. It is an interesting dichotomy. The first generation that is supposedly overdependent on screens, social media, and data, afflicted with a supposed deteriorating attention span, you have to unplug and engage in a hobby that demands routine personal attention and careful citizen scientific interventions. Admittedly, it does get a lot of likes. It also offers the unique opportunity to reach back into a hobby that has not really changed much since the 1850s. That's when U.S. Patent 9300 was issued to Philadelphia native Reverend L.L. Longstroth. He recently discovered what is bee space and applied it to a budding concept of storing frames in boxes so you could disassemble the whole hive. And that remains our standards for beekeepers across the world. People have been folding frames much the same ever since. The Montgomery County Beekeepers Association had members present in 2010 when a historical marker was put in Philadelphia outside the home where Reverend Longstroth invented the bee box. So it's kind of like a little bit of local history. As it turns out, long trough was not an anomaly by any means. The 1800s featured a well-known back-to-nature renaissance of its own, where human interaction with the natural world was under thorough examination, emphasis on thorough. One writer, particularly a German immigrant named John Adolphus Etzler, shared a surprisingly modern, dare I say, millennial perspective of merging technology in the natural world in order to eliminate the citizens' obligations to work. His aim was the 19th century utopia. In his text entitled The Paradise Within Reach of All Men, Etzler predicted a world where the man-manipulated mechanisms embedded in nature would be so advanced that they would be turned by, quote, invisible cranks to serve human means of comfort and luxury. An admirable projection that called for taming the wind, the sun, the tides, and waves for generating energy. He imagined hundreds of magnifying glasses called burning mirrors that would produce heat and steam power. Insofar as Etzler was concerned, within 10 years, he predicted the environmental scientists of his era could engineer this national utopia in the United States, taking advantage of our natural resources. America would turn that infinite reservoir into the civilization of the future. Lazy 20-somethings of the 1840s held their breath. One of those 20-somethings in the 1840s was Henry David Thoreau. And he knew of Etzler's work, and he wrote a literary response, a review, entitled A Paradise to be Regained. He questioned the desire to industrialize the natural world so that man could live in, quote, palaces of luxury. Thoreau blanched at it. He argued it is worthwhile to develop oneself through good labor, sound thought, such as love and truth and literature, and as always, a respectful appreciation of the natural world, not the command of the natural world. Etzler's utopian prediction oversimplified man's rough dominion over nature, to say the least. Quote, how meanly and grossly do we deal with nature, Thoreau wrote. He went on to reference working with nature rather than trying to domesticate it, a task not unlike that of the beekeeper. There are certain pursuits, he writes, which, if not wholly poetic and true, do at least suggest a noble and finer relation to nature than what we know. The keeping of bees, for instance, is a very slight interference. It's more like directing the very sunbeams. With a bit of sarcasm, Thoreau confronted the primary utopia issue. Eliminating labor would not improve the inherent quality of the person. He argued that it would be more worthwhile to improve the soul of the person rather than their creature comforts. Herein, the seed of my education with the UU perspective is fertilized by Thoreau's words. Quote, man shall no more earn his living by the sweat of his brow. All labor would be reduced to, quote, a short term of some crank, and, quote, taking the finished article away. But there is a crank. Oh, how hard to be turned. Could there not be a crank upon a crank, an infinitely small crank? We would ask now. But there is a certain divine energy in every man, but sparingly unemployed yet, which may be called the crank within. It is a crank, after all, the prime mover of all machinery, indispensable to all work, if only we could get our hands on that internal handle. Thoreau had it right. Beekeeping is a lot like directing a sunbeam. From the 1800s to this new millennium, stacking wooden boxes one on top of the other, beekeepers get to engage in good labor and communion with nature. The plants and the animals and the weather are all sewn together by the foraging flight of every tiny honeybee. Ironically, it's a modern invisible crank, the internet, which delivers the supplies to the garage in dozens of Amazon boxes. It's a social network of community members that offers guidance and education to any beekeeper struggling. And now in my apiary, one-on-one with these natural movers, these bees, I find I do feel myself closer to the crank within. And dare I say, I feel it turn. As I engaged in beekeeping, I drew an analogy to writing. Both writing and beekeeping, they can kind of only be done alone. The individual choices and modifications of your approach, the little minuscule interventions to recover a written piece or recover a bee colony, it's really limited to the space between one person's ears. But neither of those tasks can actually be done alone. Belonging to a community regarding either hobby enhances the skill set of the individual tenfold. In that way, we humans very much mimic the bee's eusocial approach. We can be industrious on our own. Inspiration might drive us in one direction or another, but in order to move to the higher self-actualized state, we're better served mingling with a group. From beekeeping to writing, grand architecture to cave painting, classic art to pop music, the greatest things that we produce are improved by being educated and informed within a community. So as I explained this idea to my writing group, the analogies tumbled out. We bounce from conversation to conversation, pollinating ideas. Yeah. We take the pollen of those ideas home and create sweet, sweet honey of a sort. Yeah. Until your piece gets rejected. We monitor the health of the community. We intervene to strengthen the group. It's a special connection. And then I started attending this fellowship in Pottstown, and the analogy took on an entirely new perspective. I have learned that the spiritual self, too, is definitely something that exists only between your ears. And Thoreau no doubt knew this as well. And he wrote about it a lot when he lived for 2 years, 2 months, and 2 days at Walden Pond. He wrote, "We must learn to reawaken and keep ourselves awake, not by mechanical aids, but by an infinite expectation of a new dawn, which does not forsake us even in our soundest sleep. I know of no more encouraging fact than the unquestionable ability of people to elevate their lives and the lives of others through conscious endeavor. It is something to be able to paint a particular picture or carve a statue, and so to make a few beautiful objects, but it is far more glorious to carve and paint the very atmosphere and medium which we look with our minds, which morally only we can do. To affect the quality of the day, that is the highest of arts." He went on to conclude, "Only that day dawns to which we are awake. There is more days to dawn. The sun is but a morning star." In bee colonies, there's a lot of work to be done season in and season out. There are scout bees that go out into the environment in search of good forage, only to return to the hive and report what they found. Here we have speakers who tell us about philosophies and writers that we should familiarize ourselves with so we can nourish our minds. There are nurse bees who nurture the eggs and hatch the young on the frame. And so we have RE and we have our playgrounds. There are mortuary bees. Mortuary bees clean out all the dead. And so we mourn the members of the congregation who have recently passed. There is a queen bee with attendant bees, and so we have our queen bee at the board. In unison, the bees impact their environment. No matter what job they inhabit, they are part of improving their environment. They are part of the greater mechanism that turns the crank to create a greater good. And so are you. Just by walking through the doors or logging onto the Zoom, when we congregate with those gifts that you bring to the table, however small, no matter what they are employed and activated to make a positive impact on this community. That is our honey, whether it's Kay's gardening, Cliff's cooking, Emily's presentation, Mary's photography, Miranda's passions for books, which I love, I wish Miranda's, Monica's positivity, Anna and Carly's musical abilities, all these gifts come together in this special building built by the hive itself, the same way honeycomb is built by the sweat of the bee's brow. And here we come together to turn that invisible crank within that spurs us to good labor and moral progress within ourselves and our community. The weather will not always be kind, and I wish I could cue more thunder, but we can still meet every season with new hope that we commune in this special environment and leave feeling stronger as we flit from individual moment to individual moment, from each person to person, from each day to day, just like some tiny honeybee bouncing along from one pollen-laden flower to the next. And in that way, I'm reminded of John's gift of wisdom, One of the first things he said to me when I ever showed up walking through that door, he described this congregation as small but mighty. And it really is a small but mighty hive. I think it's interesting that everybody who talks up here has a different way of concluding. And I don't want to like make it a joke or anything, but it just seems really, we just finished the Mandalorian thing, you know, Mando? And they always say, it is the way. So just because the boys are here, I wanted to finish by saying, right? It is the way.
Okay, I may ask you to come back up because I did say we had, I let a congregational discussion in there because Chad had told me sometimes he has a back and forth because he is a teacher and 14-year-olds like to talk.
Yeah.
So do we. So if anybody has anything, or we will go right to Blue Boat Home and have the discussion with the coffee cake in the back.
That's a relevant.
Okay. He has spoken. So number 1064.
Yeah.
We vote them all. This is becoming one of our favorites, I believe. Joys and concerns. If anybody has any this part. So the little cap that's sitting there, that's how you extinguish it. You just put the little cap on it. So read me along with these words. We extinguish this flame, not the light of wisdom, warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These to be buried in our hearts and in our hands until we are together again. Okay, thank you very much. And Carly, you can play us out.